But I'm here today, obviously, to talk about the new inflation figures that have just been released in the last hour or so by the ABS. The consumer price index rose 1.9% in the December quarter and 7.8% throughout 2022. I think it's worth remembering and noting that when it comes to headline inflation, the quarterly profile of that inflation in 2022 was 2.1% in the March quarter, 1.8% in both the June and September quarters, and 1.9% in the December quarter. So the biggest jump in inflation in 2022 was actually the first quarter of 2022 and not the last quarter of 2022. The trimmed mean, obviously, for the year for 2022 was 6.9%. This is very high inflation by historical standards. There's no use pretending otherwise. It's unacceptably high. It's in line with the Treasury forecasts for inflation, and it's almost as high as the Reserve Bank's forecast for inflation as well. Now, this is likely the peak in inflation, but we won't know that for sure until we get the numbers for this March quarter that we're in now. Inflation was the defining challenge in our economy in 2022, and it will be a defining challenge in our economy in 2023 as well. We are optimistic about the future of our economy and the future of our country, but we are realistic about the extreme price pressures that Australians are facing right now, the impact of interest rate hikes, and the costs and consequences of a war in Europe and a period of substantial volatility in the global economy as well. Our expectation and our hope is that inflation has now peaked, but it will still be higher than we'd like for longer than we'd like, even on the other side of the peak in inflation. Even as inflation moderates, the pressures coming at us from around the world will continue to be felt around the kitchen tables of our country. Now, the big drivers in the numbers released this morning, the big drivers of inflation were holidays and accommodation, new homes as well, and energy prices too, which is no surprise, I think, to anyone who's been following developments in our economy in recent times. And the energy price rises in the numbers released today and the forecast energy price rises in the October budget are precisely why we are acting in such a decisive way to try and take some of the sting out of these price rises, which are putting so much pressure on Australian families, pensioners, small businesses, and industries as well. It will take a little bit of time for our interventions in the energy market to flow through, and there's obviously a long way to go. But we are really quite pleased and quite encouraged to see some early evidence that our energy plan will moderate some of these energy price increases that we expected in 2023. If you think about just in the last few days, we've seen Treasury analysis that shows forecast price rises are coming off considerably. Shell is offering 8 petajoules of gas under the price cap. And just overnight, we saw new analysis from the energy market operator, which backs in the steps that we took late last year as well. I'd really encourage you to check out the AEMO report, which was released overnight. What the energy market operator has done is linked the substantial drops in expected energy prices and in the price drops that we saw at the end of the year with the market anticipating and reacting to our energy plan. Let me say that again. The energy market operator has drawn a direct link between the interventions that we made late last year with the price drops, which was the market anticipating and then responding to the steps that the Albanese government took. So we are starting to see our energy plan take some of the sting out of the energy price rises that we have been anticipating in 2023. And obviously on top of that, there is electricity bill relief coming in the budget as well, and that's an important part of our energy plan as well, to help people through a period of high and rising energy prices. Now, don't forget, when it comes to our interventions in the energy market, and when it comes to household assistance, cost of living relief in the form of electricity bill relief, that the opposition voted against all of it. If they had their way, government would do nothing to deal with these energy price rises. Industries would be smashed and hollowed out, and families and pensioners and small businesses wouldn't get any help from government at all. That's what the opposition voted for in this place when they voted against our energy plan. Now, we understand, and we have understood for some time, that the main driver of higher energy prices is the war in Ukraine. But the decade of energy policy chaos has made us more vulnerable to these sorts of international shocks. And so we're acting in the near term to take some of the edge out of these energy price rises, but we're also putting in place the energy policy certainty when it comes to cleaner and cheaper, more reliable, increasingly renewable energy, to make sure that we're making up for that, the missed opportunities of the last decade as well. Now, energy is a big part of the inflation story, but it's not the only part of the inflation story. We still have pressure on supply chains. We still have the consequences of natural disasters. We still have the workforce shortages in our economy that the budget and our plan has been designed to begin to deal with. Because of all of these reasons, because of all of these pressures, our three highest priorities in our economic plan are to make the budget more responsible, the economy more resilient, and to provide cost of living relief where we can do that responsibly without adding to inflation. These were the priorities in the October budget, and they will be the priorities in the May budget as well. Paul.
Rents are rising very fast in the major cities. Now, we know you want responsible cost of living relief, but can you please explain where increasing the rent assistance component of government payments, where that ranks in terms of its cost and in terms of its priority for you?
Well, obviously, when it comes to the various government payments and pensions, we keep them under constant review. And we always try and do what we can to make sure that people on fixed incomes are able to keep up with the rising cost of living. The indexation is obviously a really important part of that, but I understand that there are people around the country and around the community that would like us to do more, whether it's rent assistance, whether it's single parents, whether it's job seeker, or some of these other payments that have been prominent in all of your stories and in much of the economic conversation for some time now. We understand that when it comes to rental properties in particular, there aren't enough of them. You know, we've got vacancy rates incredibly low. We've got the growth in rental costs faster than we'd like. And so the most important thing we can do is build more supply. We don't have enough affordable properties for people to live in, particularly where the jobs and opportunities are being created. And so my colleague Julie Collins, the whole cabinet, is focused on delivering more social and affordable houses, whether it's the Housing Australia Future Fund or the housing accord that we announced in the October budget. We need to get more supply into the system. When it comes to various payments and pensions, they're obviously typically under constant review. We'll go to Ron, and then we'll go to Pat, and then we'll go to Rachel.
Treasurer, we saw a fairly significant decline in fruit and vegetable prices over the quarter. I think you previously indicated your expectation was that the floods across the eastern seaboard would be putting upward pressure. Are you still expecting to see that come through in the first half of this year? And then just have you given any thought to replacing Sean Hughes as the Asset Commissioner, given he's announced his exit ahead of schedule?
Yeah, so a couple of parts of that. I mean, firstly, when it comes to fruit and vegetable prices in particular, I think if you ask most families around Australia, they still feel like that's a substantial part of the pressure that they feel. And obviously natural disasters, when they occur in our prime agricultural land, they have an impact. That number has come in lower than many people expected, but another reminder of the swings and roundabouts in these inflation figures. You know, over the course of recent months, you know, fuel hasn't gone up by as much as what people were anticipating. Shipping costs had come off a bit, and so inevitably, when you're forecasting some of these numbers, there will be an element of swings and roundabouts, even though the number that came out today is in line with what the Treasury expected in aggregate. When it comes to ASIC, I think it's entirely appropriate that we have a proper merit-based selection process for the replacement at ASIC, and so that's what I've asked to occur. And typically when you run a process like that, you get some advice from the Treasury and from elsewhere about the best way to fill that vacancy. I don't have a preconceived view about how we might fill the vacancy left by his departure. I'll put a lot of thought into it, and I'll rely very heavily, of course, on the merit-based selection process, which will be underway.